So now we continue with the setup that we'll be looking at here, which is that we'll be focusing on translating solitons. So either they evolve just by translations that are constant in speed and fixed direction. So, and then if you have a hypersurface here in Rn plus one, then it's not so hard to see that this is a time slice, you could say, of one of these translating soliton movements, if and only if the beam curvature vector equals some constant here. So and then so then we have this constant vector field here, and without loss generality we can just assume that this one is always the up direction on a Cartesian system, so we'll always take it to be E3 and R3, and then the up translation is then the same saying that the mean curvature at each point of the surface equals the normal vector dotted with the E3 direction, and then with a minus if you want the up translation direction here. Okay, and so as you can see, this is still of course a quasi-linear PDE, but now it's an elliptic differential equation, right? Partial differential equation, because the time coordinate is gone, has been fixed, right? And then of course all these time slices here are just as you by definition translates of each other, so it's just also enough to look at this time slice and at the elliptic PDE. So it's a bit like the mean curvature equals to zero, so the minimal surface equation, or you could say it's a sort of perturbation with a gradient term of sorts of that, right? That's one way to think about. Okay, so this means that yeah, a lot of the local theory is pretty well understood, and of course what we will like to look at is the global geometry of solutions, so complete hypersurfaces that satisfy this everywhere. Okay. It's of course not so hard to see that you cannot have any compact examples of self-translating hypersurfaces. One way to show that you can't would be, right, I mean, to take your compact thing that was supposed to be self-translating, then put a sphere around it, and then no compact, let's see, and then use the avoidance principle, right, so then you have to translate out of the sphere, which is swinging at the same time. Okay, so that would lead to a contradiction. So and let's move on a little bit here, so because we want some more examples. I already said yeah, now you know you can't have any of these compact examples. Some of the examples we've already talked a bit about and seen illustrated, but let's look at some more examples. So if you think about the vertical hyperplanes, so think about, for example, in R3, it's the E3 direction, just the translation direction, then the vertical hyperplanes are actually self-translators. So remember, again, we have this thing about reparametrizing, so our time slices, so then it doesn't really move, right, because it has mean curve to zero, but if you think about it this way, it actually does translate up along the E3 direction if it's a vertical one containing the E3 vector. And so this phenomenon, you can see more generally that if I take any minimal surface here in one dimension lower, so I take an n minus one surface in Rn, and I can cross here with the copy of a line here, and then this actually now becomes a self-translator. You have to cross, of course, in the translation direction, so the final variable here. Okay, but this also means that now you can already see that if you know that there are many, many examples which there are of minimal surfaces, for example, two surfaces, that you can very easily cross them and get some three-dimensional translating surfaces in R4, for example, right? So loads and loads of those. and then there's another type of construction here where, for example, where classically you take this Grimm Reaper curve, we'll soon enough look at that. That's actually the one that appeared already in the material science paper by Mullins in 1956. Then you can also cross that and with the whole Rn minus one. So then you get an n-dimensional surface in Rn plus one. Okay. So that's another one of these product phenomena, you could say. And of course, to show it, if you haven't worked with this before, well, I mean, so then you should just sit down and compute the mean curvature of these and look at the equation and see that it works. Okay, and then there are also some of these rotationally symmetric translators, a so-called ball translator. I have it actually on a slide there, slide on the next slide. It's also, it looks a bit like paraboloid, and then there's also a catenoid version of that. And then by these various gluing techniques, which were started for translators and some of these, you could say, flat situations here by Nguyen, these repo cylinder constructions and planes. And then for self-strengthers, then they were done by Kapolis, Clean, and myself in this paper 11, and about the same time by Nguyen. And then these similar constructions that use this rotationally symmetric dihedral symmetry were then done by a couple of different teams for rotationally symmetric translators, by Smith and Davila, Delpino, and Nguyen also. And then there's the story of these delta wings, which, you can see that in a couple of teams of researchers here, Boni, Langford, and Tenaglia, and Hoffman, Elman, and Martin, and White, then they have looked at constructing these so-called delta wing solutions, which I'll leave to you to look up what they look like. And then, well, they are graphs over strips, and they're in fact the unique graph, Konex graphs over wide strips. Okay, so yes, and so here are actually some of these pictures as promised. So this Grim Reaper that goes all the way back to Mullins. You can see with this formula minus log of cosine, so it has a couple of these asymptotes here, and so this translates upwards, this one, right? And that's actually the one you saw in the little applet demonstration that that you can get when you have a curve which is only immersed, not embedded. Remember, we had these, I can draw it actually here, we had these I drew or something like this. So, and then you will see actually one forming here. So of course it'll be translating in that direction there. So maybe my drawing is a bit crowded already, but I can try to draw it. So we have this direction there. If you rescale, you see that. And then this nice explicit formula minus log of cosine. And then here's the one, right, where you do the so-called Grim Reaper cylinder here. Well, okay, it actually says also up in the top of the slide, Grim Reaper cylinders. Those are what we mean by those, these ones, right? So you cross with a flat in minus one. Okay. And so, as I also mentioned, right, these rotationally symmetric translators, so they look like this. So the rotationally symmetric translating graphs here, the ones on the left here, that look a bit like a paraboloid. Of course, it is not exactly, but they were found by Altschul and Wu in 94. What else is there to say? Well, of course, they translate upwards. And then Clutterbuck, Schnur, and Schultz in 07 found these kind of catenoid versions of these, you could say, right? So they're no longer graphs. You should think of them maybe as taking two of these on the left, and maybe you insert a little catenoid here down here to connect these two, right? So, and then rotation around this axis, around the axis of translation. And there's a whole family of them, right? So you can sort of move these, make this hole larger or smaller. Okay. And look a bit like this kind of paraboloidal ends here. Okay. So, let's see. Oh yeah, and maybe I should also comment on that some of these that you can do by gluing that I mentioned. So they are, for example, where you take this one and you can insert it in the middle here, and you hit maybe the blue circle here, and then here you can insert some genus, and then you can make these higher genus ones, the three ends. Okay, and then a couple of comments, which is it's meant also a bit to connect to those in the audience who are more used to looking at partial differential equations than on the geometric things. So if we consider graphical translators in R3, then a bit more is known. So here you have again on the left hand side the mean curvature, on the right hand side you have this that I called a a nonlinear perturbation term. You could think of, right? Of course it could be quite large. So but then in this situation, if you combine some of these now classical results here by XJ Wang from Annals and 11, and combined with this Sprock Shao showing the convexity, and then the classification by Hoffman, Ilman, and Martin and White recently, then you can bake them into this multi-theorem here, showing that if you have some two-dimensional graphical translators that are not necessarily convex, because that falls from these authors' work, then the domains that can support such a graph here, it has to be either all of R2, so entire graphs, or over slabs in R2. Okay, so it's an interesting case here of having solutions over domains decides for you what the domain can look like. So now we're getting close to some of these phenomena that we are discussing here today. So just a small interlude here about another way to think about some of these problems, because if you have a hypersurface, which is a self-translator, so I'm just writing the self-translator elliptic PDE here that we already are working with, then in fact, this is satisfied if and only if you are a minimal submanifold of this conformally flat metric that you put on Euclidean space. So you essentially have just something like an exponential function in the translation directions as variable in the final variable here, and then you rescale Euclidean space. So, it really only depends on this. So this leads to this little heuristics cliffhanger here, you could say, that does the projection then, where it's project in this direction, so back down to the level of, let's say, xn plus 1 equals 0, does that in some way behave a bit like Euclidean minimal submanifolds in one dimension less? It's really also related to, if you remember on the list of examples, right, I had these examples of this form, I called them tilde like this, and then I made some of these n minus 1 cross r n dimensional surfaces inside r n plus 1 by taking a minimal surface and then getting a translator there. So this is, you can say, the heuristics cliffhanger is asking a bit about going the other way, right? So what happens if I take one which is not of this form and I project, I recover some properties of this one? And a bit further also in this direction, then there's this, again, you could say multi-theorem of sorts, because a lot of authors worked on it. And so this version, which you have here, where there are no assumptions on boundedness or graphicality and so on, is from a paper of mine from 14. But then there were other similar versions with more assumptions on in these authors' papers. Shariari did graphs, and Martin Savas-Hallhaus-Moksuk had it with boundedness from below. And then you can show that there are no probably immersed translators without boundary contained in a vertical cylinder. Okay, which is then again, it has to be a cylinder which has the long direction and the direction of translation, right? In a way, you could say, actually, as we'll get to soon enough, I mean, most of these things will be trivially true if you have a cylinder which is turned the other way, so that you kind of would crash out of it. Okay, so, but anyway, another way of reformulating this in language of this, these projections is that you take a properly embedded translator without a boundary, and then you can look at the projection in the direction of translation, and then what you get there, that set cannot be a bounded set. Okay, and so maybe I should say, this properly, right? So I'm sure you know that this means, if not, then I'm explaining it now, that if you have your surface, then whenever you intersect with a compact ball here, BR, which is an ambient ball here, let's say, well, on more general compact sets, but then you want this to be a compact set, right? So this rules out that you could have, for example, what about something like a disk without the boundary here, right? So then you will not get a compact set when you intersect with these closed balls. Let me just put this to emphasize the closed ball. So this means that in particular, this actually ensures closeness as a subset of the image space and ensures completeness in the sense of Riemannian geometry. What else should I say about it? No, yeah, of course, then it also rules out that you could have some things which would do something like spiraling into a, let's say we had maybe an open, we were in an open disk here, and then spiraling, if my surface was this one in here, doing some spiraling thing like this, this would also be ruled out by properness. And in fact, it's an essential thing to require this, these sorts of theorems. So because here's a counterexample, which is the counterexample that I'm mentioning, which will be a counterexample to everything you see in this mini course. Whenever it says we assume properness, then if we don't, then in all the cases, this counterexample would work. Okay, but that's because Nadiashvili has this example from the 90s of a minimal surface, which is so it's immersed into a ball of some finite radius. Let's just say something like this, and it's also complete. Okay, so it's a complete immersion, and it's minimal also. So minimal, complete immersion into a ball. But of course, well, it's not proper. Okay, so it's an example of something that's not proper. Okay, and you can also see how wrong everything would go here. Well, for example, up here, a theorem like this one. There you could do our product phenomenon, take this Nadiashvili surface, and then cross with R, and this, for example, would give you a three-dimensional, right? Let's say that this is the Nadiashvili, then this would give you something which is a translator in R4, three-dimensional translator in R4, and then this would have, a bounded projection, right? So this is all a counterexample, and as I say, it will really always be a counterexample to anything that we say proper. Okay, these types of things. So of course, yeah, I would say that lower dimensions curves and so on, we don't actually worry so much about in this mini course. So because there, it's not so hard to classify, for example, the translators there. Okay. Let me then mention what is known about minimal surfaces in the spirit, really, of this half-space theorem that worked for two dimensions only. But then Hoff and Mixi also looked at, in the same paper, they looked at higher dimensional minimal submanifolds. And then they proved that you can classify the convex hull always of these minimal surfaces. And so this says that if you take a properly immersed minimal submanifold with compact boundary, could be empty boundary, then you take the convex hull of this, as I said, inside our n plus one, and then you have exactly one of the following situations for the convex hull. You could get all of our n, so convex hull, you could get a half space, or you could get a closed slab between two parallel hyperplanes. You get, of course, a hyperplane itself. Or in the case where you have a compact boundary, then you could have some compact convex set. Okay. And so the way it's proven in Hoffman-Mixi's paper is by using what we can call a wedge theorem or a bi-half space theorem. And what does such a theorem say? Well, it says that if you take two different half spaces, so which have an angle, so they're not parallel, you can imagine something maybe like a book that you open in the middle, and then so you have some wedge like that, so some wedge, and then you try to place here inside your wedge, you try to place a minimal surface, and then if it's properly immersed, and even with a compact boundary component allowed, so it would be some boundary component here, so then this is never allowed if you're a minimal surface. Okay. And so the proof here is by constructing certain, we call them apple slices, because this is a bit what they look like. Because the way you do it is you take a wedge, I'm just turning it here because I'm a bit out of space at the bottom of the slide here. So you have your wedge here. Okay. And then what you do is you pick some point down here on the spine of your little book here, and then you put intersect with balls here, and then you get this boundary here. You get these sort of boundaries that look a bit like the edges of an apple slice. Now you solve the plateau problem with this boundary. We could say this way: it's a boundary, right, of the wedge intersected with the ball. Maybe I also call this ball. Sorry for writing a bit clearly here. So okay, so this is the boundary, and then you do plateau solutions on that. Okay, and then if you have now your minimal surface that you assume sits out here, the one that has maybe some compact boundary components also. So and then what you do is you keep growing the radius of this ball and hence this apple slice until you get a point where it touches the first time here, and then this violates the two-sided maximum principle for the minimal submanifolds. This is sort of in brief terms the argument, the proof in the paper. And so let's go back then to trying something similar for the self-translating solitons. Of course, we have to figure out exactly what we can expect. So, first of all, we have many examples. As I said, at least as many as there are minimal surfaces in one dimension lower always. We can't really expect to classify them. And then, even if we start doing this with projecting away in the direction of translation, where we know right that we can go the other way, so to say, with minimal surface examples, then for that reason also we have a pretty wild set of examples there in some non-precise meaning of the word. That was actually the first and the second line I said now. And then if you take the convex hulls, which for minimal surfaces would allow you to classify these five types that we saw, four types if you don't admit a boundary. And then if you look at these examples that we mentioned on one of the previous slides for translators, well, there are so many of these examples, for example, from gluing constructions and so on, that this is pretty wild to class, that you cannot really expect to classify this one. But what we will show here in this course is that if you take both the convex hull and the projection, you can actually also swap the directions of the two if you want, of course, but then it's actually classifiable, and you can only have these finite number of types that can happen. So with a sort of language from topologists, then these are some forgetful operations to apply to the class until you finiteness, right? So you do projections in the translation direction, and then you take the convex hull, and then we claim that this is a finite set of types. And so here's our theorem here that you can find in the archive version or in the published version now. And so let's see. So we have again, right, a properly immersed translator, and we allow a compact boundary. And now this convex hull of the projection and translation direction again has to be one of these five types. So this is just now the same list of things that you have: slabs, or you could say the degenerate cases of slabs. Right? A slab could include a hyperplane in one degenerate direction, so to say, or include a half space, or it could be all of our in. And then, of course, you have the compact boundary version of it also. And so how to prove that? Well, then we need to have wedge theorem, right, for translators. Okay, so let me state this as the last thing in this second lecture video. So if I take two half spaces in Rn, well, that are not parallel like before for minimal surfaces, and then now we actually assume that these two hyperplanes are vertical, okay, parallel to the translation direction, then the wedge region does not contain any non-compact, probably immersed translator with compact boundary. And so some remarks, right, about why we need to say this verticalness. Well, so one of them, if you take, let's say we had this this book, open book here, this is what we made in the wedge region. Then what if I took something like a translating Grim Reaper cylinder, if I did gamma cross R n minus one, well, then this will just translate out of this wedge region, right? So then the theorem is wrong, right? Is it in this way? So so that case the theorem would be wrong. Okay, so that's why we are ruling out such things by saying vertical, you could say. What about the other things, the other way of not being vertical? Well, you could also imagine having a slab, well, rather a wedge, like region, and then maybe you had a translator which somehow managed to translate into that direction. Then it's not so hard to see that this will violate the maximum principle at some point. So yeah, so this is why we then only consider, we can say, the case that is non-trivial and is not wrong. Okay, so that's the vertical situation. So, and then this is what I'm saying here also, there, so verticality is optimal in that sense. And then properness, you can again take the same counterexample. If you didn't have properness, you could take Nader-Rasmussen's counterexample and then plug that in and get a counterexample. So then the term would be wrong. And then, yeah, compactness of the boundary is also not so hard to see that if you're allowed to chop along a non-compact boundary, the conclusion is false. You could take even, just let's say now we look at actually a wedge in this direction that we naturally probably would think about it. And then what if I just take a Reaper cylinder, but I only take half of it, right? So before when I draw it, I actually meant that it extends in all directions, but here maybe I actually took one here with a non-compact boundary, okay, which is just chopping half a Reaper cylinder here. And then you could easily put that in a wedge shape region. So that's to say that, yeah, then you have to for sure assume compactness of the boundary for the theorem to be true. And so this concludes this second video, and then in the next video, then we'll get to the proof of this of these theorems.